Hi, my name is Tristan Edwards. I'm a senior trading mentor at the Institute of Trading and Portfolio Management. Just arrived here in Recife, Brazil, and we're getting ready to welcome the guys. Anton is out and about preparing for the week ahead. Should be a good week.
Orientation day, it's like first day where everyone turns up and we just chill, relax by the bar, by the pool. Guys are jet lagged and go out for a nice meal and go to bed early, and then we have the classroom the next day.
Hi, nice to meet you.
We're going to a really good fine dining seafood restaurant that's really well known in Recife. So just want to break the guys in and let them know that this is going to be a really high-end week.
Amazing,
yeah.
Great people, good laugh, just pretty cool, good start.
We spent quite a lot of time talking about the soft shell crab, which was amazing. He was asking me about emotional attachment to P&L. Is there one right way to act in a certain situation? And just talking about how every situation is different and trade in a way that suits your personality. Work as hard as you can to be disciplined to that process. You learn all your lessons, losing money, not making money. So try and make sure that those lessons aren't too expensive.
See Anton in real in action, his take on economies, the markets. I'll have a lot of questions for him. Right now, just enjoying the food, and then tomorrow, I think the real work will start.
Welcome to Brazil.
Cheers.
People always say, like, you know, the precursor to joining the Euros. So today is the first session of the classroom, and the usual situation is we concentrate on the trade idea generation process. And I think today what we're going to do as well is focus, to begin with, on institute trader statistics, and specifically guys that tend to struggle in the first 3 months of their mentoring programs and their life of becoming an institute trader, and what those guys do when they struggle and why they struggle. Because if we show these guys the habits of what happens when you struggle in the first stage of your trading life, the guys will be able to identify with those habits. So if those habits happen to them, they can correct them very quickly. And then we're just going to go straight into the process of trade idea generation as well.
I think everyone's very optimistic. It's a good setup, it's a good format. Everyone seems well prepared. Interesting to see what the different views are, if there's any consensus. And I think for the first day, probably they won't be tested too much, but then they'll get some homework and come back tomorrow and justify their thinking, justify their ideas, and have to defend them to the group. So, yeah, I think it's going to be a good start to the week.
Now, if you've been through the Institute's education online, you know the bad habits already of the guys who are outside the Institute and how and why most retail traders lose money. That's not what this presentation concentrates on. What this concentrates on is the difference between the best and the worst guys within the Institute once they've been through the education. So let's look at this guy, trader U15027666. He started off with $24,975 in March 2015. So what's he done? April 15, he takes some positions. Now, we don't even need to know what the positions are, because we can see from the risk-return profile what type of trader this guy is.
It's good to see that actually.
Yeah,
it's interesting.
I think seeing consistent mistakes is encouraging in that there's not a wide range of things people do wrong and everyone has a different issue. There's a fairly common set of problems that people tend to make. And if you identify what they are, then you can work to avoid them.
Yeah.
You know, from our side, it's obviously an informational privilege to be able to access this stuff, because what it does is it eventually creates a feedback loop of learning, because you can teach the educational video series online and anyone can take that stuff anywhere in the world. But the next step is always to put it into practice with real money. Now, if you're inside the Institute, especially if you're doing mentoring programs on location, we can sit down with you and show you this information so you can learn from it, and it creates a feedback loop within the community. So guys get even better than they would have if they didn't have access to this information. But you know, the main advantage of this as well is that because there's no discrimination, the numbers are the numbers. So whether you're a 55-year-old who's sitting in the United States and you used to be a truck driver, if your numbers are for trading are really, really good, you know, there's no discrimination about your background. If you're a 22-year-old female in a European country who's a student and you've never really worked or been in a business environment, if your numbers for trading are really good, there's no discrimination against you. And it really is, trading really is just all about that. It's not about your background, it's not about where you're from, it's not about your attitude, what you consume, whatever. It's how much money you make on a risk-adjusted return. And that's it.
Which sheet is that? I don't remember seeing that.
This one is the community support from the Institute is very, very helpful, definitely. Having people sitting above you, kind of watching, making sure things aren't going off track, pulling you into line if they are, and just the you know, the data, the support network, the infrastructure, all those things are very helpful. And you know, the context of what you learn through the courses definitely gives you a lot more a lot more structure and a lot more confidence in what you're doing, the way you're executing.
Right, so this guy, let's formalize his stats. Look at his annualized standard deviation, you know, 15-16%. It's great. It's so consistent. It's not even jumping around, you know, like.
And it's in the right absolute level as well.
Yeah, there's no jack in the box moves every single month.
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome start to his trading career or life. Okay. You can't hope for a better start than that. It's amazing. Down 2 months out of 9 months with a max drawdown of 2.4%. Insanity.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing. Ridiculous. Hardly ever see that ever. Annualizing a 47% return with a 16% standard deviation in his portfolio. So if he does that over the next year, he's definitely a guy that could go to a hedge fund.
Yeah.
Because he's done it with his own money, our money, and now he's ready. So that's what you want to see. That's exactly what you want to be doing.
The guy that is going to make a lot more money returning 20% on their own money and then moving to the hedge fund and running $100 million and getting paid on a much bigger multiple of AUM than a guy who runs his own money, runs 50 grand for himself, has a big swing, returns 50 to 100%. I guess the point is, if you're aiming to return 15 to 25% on a good adjusted risk, you end up in a hedge fund running $100 million and it'll pay a lot more than doubling 50 grand ever could.
He's like the perfect representation of everything that we're trying to achieve at the Institute. And obviously you can't do that with every single person and everyone goes on their own journey. But again, the feedback loop of learning. What are the bad habits of the guys that struggle? So you recognize them in yourself when they're actually happening and you can change them. And what do you need to work towards? It's that. That's exactly what you need to work towards.
It isn't easy. Like, none of these guys who are doing it really well are doing it because it's easy or they've found an easy way to do it. They're all doing, one thing they're all doing is they're all working really hard. They're putting a lot of effort in. And you have to, otherwise you can't go into this thinking it's just gonna be easy and I don't have to do much. It just doesn't work that way. If you do put the effort in and you do the right things, then this is what you can come up with.
So if you're gonna write down your trading plan for the next 3 months, what would you write down? What would you write down? First of all, the things that you don't want to do in the next 3 months, just from the evidence that you've seen. Write them down.
Yeah, I think it was a question that we all had, everybody has, early on as you're trying to choose what training that you're looking for. There are different options, different choices to make in the training. And you get some of these hints. It's always a question that you want to ask, but this is real numbers, real examples. 10 case studies where we're seeing the good and the bad and learning from the negative and positive.
So we're just down the road from the hotel, so we're heading over to the hotel beach club for the afternoon, do a bit of work, get some sunshine, and prepare for classroom tomorrow.
For lunch?
I think this is the life, and it's giving us a taste of what can happen if things go well, and fantastic way of learning. This is how learning should happen.
The most money in the market is crowded over a time period of 6 to 18 months expectation. So as the expectations shift from year to year, period to period, money has to shift. So you're timing your money before the money has to shift.
Well, we're discussing a particular play for earnings seasons on Q3 in particular, and that play is quite tactical. And very interesting because it's very extremely low risk and quite extremely high reward. It's got to be part of my playbook for sure.
Yeah, the utility of, well, first of all, just discussing things around the pool, you know, in your downtime. You know, these are just, these are not formalized classroom conversations. These are things that I talk about all day, every day to like friends. So, you know, this is just generalist conversation. It's also getting the guys in the mindset that, you know, even in your downtime, you should be thinking about trades, and it should really be your hobby, and your hobby is a bit of an obsession.
So prior to coming on the mentoring, I came up with an entire list of questions that I've done from having built my own watch list and done my fundamental analysis. So there's been some hiccups there. There've been some questions that I wanted to clarify with my mentor. Tristan's been kind enough to take out some time, so we're on a one-to-one basis to go through some of those questions. So they range from idea generation, managing your portfolio, what to do in certain situations, if there are general guidelines, but it's all relative, how to manage your day-to-day life, some psychology aspects as well, and just generally how the world works in terms of the economies and trading. I'm trying to draw upon his years of experience within the industry to make sure I don't make any, well, far fewer mistakes and have a better trading lifetime.
I've got time, I don't mind sitting down, and there's no clock. If it takes 5 minutes, it takes 5 minutes. If it takes an hour, it takes an hour. If you're over the phone talking about these things, you've got to block out some time. That cannibalizes your own life. We're all here, you know, if it's for 10 days, we've got unlimited time within that 10 days to discuss whatever we want to discuss. If the questions are well thought out and prepared, all the better. And often one question can lead to 3 or 4 different topics. Interesting or worth talking about. You get that back and forth. I'm a big believer in matching a process to personality type. I think that is the secret sauce. That is the critical element. And you'd be amazed how many professional investors haven't thought this through or don't even talk about it. One of the luxuries that retail investors have that a lot of professional traders don't have is the ability to pick the process that they operate in.
whether it's short-term, long-term, DCS, value investing, quant, whatever it might be. You join a fund and you have to do things their way. As a retail trader, you have the luxury to try and adapt your process to suit your personality type, and I think that's a massive advantage.
Tide is probably in. The sharks are hungry.
So by the end of the week, I think the guys will have two or three positions they like on the long side and the short side. They'll have a good template to follow. They'll have a good understanding on how to build out a watch list. It'll probably save them 4 weeks of mentoring.
Fixed ourselves for 20 minutes for the first, and then after that,
Embrace it, the losses are expected, they're part of the journey. But it's lumpy, that's the part that's hard for people. It's not a consistent monthly in and out, it is a lumpy process. Which is why it should never be your source of income. Always have another source of income.
That's why we say cash flow your accounts. You've got to have cash flow outside.
Correct. That is why the best traders in the world always get a base salary.
Whether it's fundamentals, technicals, whatever. People try to turn things into a science.
Yeah.
And when it goes over that kind of like grey threshold where it's useful, then you go over that grey threshold, and in that grey threshold it's, is it useful? And then it goes over that to it's total nonsense.
Agreed.
Like,
yeah, completely agree.
People try to turn like technical analysis into a science. It's not a science. You're not a surgeon. You're not doing open heart surgery. You know, it's like you're analyzing literally demand and supply.
To prevent you making a mistake, give you conviction on your fundamental view, time entry, time exit. That's all it is. The thing I was best at was short-term trading. Into the hedge fund traders, I trade the shortest time frames you would trade. And I did every time frame of Brevin you could imagine. And the one time frame that I could never make work was intraday. And I was a professional short-term trader. Intraday does not work as a trading time frame. There's no supply and demand pattern intraday, it's just noise. And I used to run black boxes that would trade intraday. I would actually have to trade for them, and it was just noise. Anyone who tells you trading intraday as a strategy is either an idiot or a con man. I promise you, that is the truth.
So what were typical trading periods for you as a short-term trader?
1 week to 3 months. For me or for the guys at Brevin? For me, depending on the market, in a bull market, 1 week to 3 months. In a post-08 market, 3 days to 6 weeks.
This volatility is double, basically. So you can get away with having half the time frame and getting the same return. Yeah. Like for the retail
people
guy,
complicate.
It's very surprising. For a retail it's so guy, it's very surprising always to hear ex-Goldman Sachs guys going, it's actually not that complicated.
Yeah.
And
easy.
Literally.
First to Anton, because he's put together a very good course and I'm impressed with the rigor. I really am.
literally and metaphorically, to get a new perspective on things. Opens up the worldview, you could say. I couldn't help but think about bulk dry good indexes and new building permits as we flew over the suburbs. So it was stimulating. Great fun.
So he's going to present his first attempt at a long idea, going through the whole trade idea generation process. So after he presents that, we'll go through each stage of his thinking and his process to see how we actually got to that point through each stage of the idea generation process. Then the guy should start to really get and understand how to do this properly.
So just to introduce what I've done so far and how I came up with the idea, I just started the full process from a top point of view, so from a macro point of view, as the process describes it. And within machinery, this is where I went to my idea selection.
Give me the main reason why you pick machinery over the others.
The fact they were growing 3 months in a row from a contraction and from a longer historical change, I thought that it might have been an opportunity here, and a breakout a breakout of the sector.
So, next question: how many stocks are in your sector that you created?
From memory, I ended up with 230.
So the answer anyone's looking for is okay. So tell me how you created this sector. Well, here's a broader definition of the sector. Here's the broader definition averages. I used these filters to get this broader definition. And then I pulled these out and these out and these out, and I've got my own subsectors. So I'm comparing apples to apples. So then in your analysis, what have you got, 20, 25?
Yeah.
Based on greater than a billion.
28.
The conclusion of your process is literally one sentence. You want to know, at the end of your sector process, definitively, what money likes in the sector and what money dislikes in the sector on a relative basis. We've probably discussed this now for like 2 or 3 hours. And what we've been discussing is just the answer to the question, what are the sector averages? And all they are is 6 numbers, and they're fractions. Defining your own sectors is actually extrapolating all the data yourself and using common sense and applying common sense filters. So what we've been going through here is, you know, the typical filters that you would use to get to a point where you've created your own sector that totally makes common sense as a representative snapshot of what's happening in the market. So at every stage of the process, the muscle memory of doing it through practice gets them in a position where they can do it with their eyes closed.
And hopefully it's making sense and it's tightening up the stuff they've already seen on the videos and the stuff they're already trying to do themselves. I guess there's always going to be some learning, some trial and error. But, you know, they all seem quite enthusiastic. And
of course, teamwork. Teamwork is essential on everything in life. It's impossible to do or to go alone along the way. It's completely impossible. There's no other way to go, in my opinion, because Tristan and Anton, they also have learned with the support of other colleagues when they were at hedge funds and investment banks. There will be, for sure, plenty of details that will be missing on the interpretation that we make from the market itself. There's plenty of work to do here. It's hours and hours and hours to get there and to have a clear picture where to bet our money.
I'll do it again.
Yeah, cool. It's hard, I think, being mentored without this classroom first. At least the first couple of weeks, you haven't met the guys before. It's hard to explain this stuff over the phone. You can't see the body language, you can't really gauge. You know, are they responding to it? Are they drowning in it? Are they lost? Are they confused? And with these guys now, I'm pretty confident that day one when we start mentoring, all this stuff will be nailed down, it'll all be correct. Won't need to spend any time going over it, reviewing it, checking it, and just jump straight into the stuff that matters.
Right, so next stage is, which one did you pick and why?
So,
the market is potentially not pricing in
the earnings that we might be seeing in the near term, and potentially we could be early entering a stock that has more growth coming that's currently being paid for by the market. So the reason in this situation we're looking at the option market and seeing what the options are trading at is because the event, the catalyst, is earnings. It's defined, it's a few weeks away, and with the options the downside is defined as well. And if you can buy the at the money options at the right price, then in this scenario it's probably worth owning the options. It's, the risk reward's better.
I want to learn options as an alternative strategy, because I understand that the risk and reward is profile is different. It is more sophisticated, but I think that's what exposure to this group, this group gives the opportunity for that, and learning from these people and having colleagues near us, then we can. I'm sure that between us, we have enough information to share to help us learn and have a confidence of making that kind of decision.
So, although you've been through the process today, and now when you go through it again, but on the short side, it should be easier because all you have to do is apply the same process, same principles, but flip it on its head. They're harder to find. So you need to go digging. And just to close the loop on things as well, you know, the next session is on Monday, so you've got 2 days. You need to finish the work on that one and fill in all the gaps. And you need to fill in all the gaps on the analysis there. You need to close the loop on the process. So at least you've been through the process once, fully. Good. So let's go for dinner.
Where are we going?
Spetus. Fine dining. Fine dining Brazilian barbecue.
Sweet.
Great.
Don't worry, don't have salad.
It was, I would say, essential. For anything from my own experience, my own business and beyond, you know, process is essential to be able to achieve something first, and today practicing this live from a homework that has been asked, you know, going step by step, being pointed out where I was wrong and why I was wrong, it's just extremely helpful. Now the next step will be to repeat it several times until it becomes easier and faster, and getting that accuracy in very simple things. And now we've been given all what we need.
It was a hard session. I don't think they're expecting it to be quite as in depth. I think they'll find the next session much easier. This was the deep end day.
Cheers.
Chin chin.
That's not a bad answer.
Thanks.
What's that?
Where's the lobster?
Man. Got outside.
Well, go on then.
It doesn't stop until you beg for mercy, and then it does stop again. Just thinking.
Look at that.
Yes.
Is this something you haven't had yet?
Serve and turf.
No, I suspect I have.
Yes.
It just moves.
Actually, that's a good trick.
Kristen, really, I'm impressed. Yeah, you are a professional eater, of course, come on.
What is that? Actually, hang on.
Don't know.
I don't know, but for me.
It's turkey with bacon.
Oh, yeah, I'm trying to listen.
He could have said anything.
Left-hand side, Porto defending us. I think it's going to be quite busy because it's Sunday. It's okay, not to worry. So everybody jumps in their boats and goes left.
Florida to Cuba, go fast boats.
Yeah, looking very good.
Is like a tanker ship trying to cross the Pacific. It's not going to change its course. It's got a long-term goal in mind. Whereas a hedge fund is more like a speedboat like this, just zipping around the harbour, never going to try and cross the Pacific. It's got a much shorter duration, much shorter time frame, and it responds. It's more nimble and it just responds to different things.
So we're having a very local Brazilian experience here. We're at a very popular local beach outside Recife called Porto de Galinhas. It's where all the locals come at the weekend to have a nice time on the beach. Lots of families meet up, gather, have a nice time, spend the day chilling out, drinking caipirinhas, having beers, having fried food on the beach, just having a nice time basically, just chill out time. So brought the guys down here, obviously outside the classroom. We're still in our downtime chatting about trading, portfolio management, guiding these guys, helping them to become better, and filling in all the details of the curriculum. It's an environment where everyone's relaxed. And when everyone's at ease, people always ask the questions that they want to ask. There are no stupid questions. And doing this type of stuff repetitively throughout the week, not just inside the classroom but outside, creates a scenario where everybody opens up and learning accelerates.
This is exactly what I love about Brazil, this sort of spot, this sort of setup.
Yeah. This is very Brazilian.
I love it. It is very Brazilian.
The thing is, if I go short defensive, I will be much less exposed to the economical cycle because they are defensive.
Right, but if you go short, I mean, everything's with risk. If you go short defensives and long growth, and we go into a bull market, and hedge funds and pension funds start positioning themselves for growth, you make a lot of money. On your longs and your shorts, probably. But if you get that wrong, and there's a problem, because the world's still quite fragile, and people start rushing to defensive names and unwinding the growth trade, you'll be on the wrong side of that, and you'll lose money on your long and your short.
Okay.
We still have to figure out why we should commit money to those positions, because he's going to ask us that tomorrow. We have to tell him why.
And it stayed with me forever, okay? And it was from one of the top guys at Goldman Sachs in Europe. And he was like one of the legends, partner at Goldman Sachs, made hundreds of millions for himself, okay? The comment is, you don't know anything until you have a position. Make that assumption, okay? So you can do the idea generation process, you can look at risk management, size positions correctly, everything. And then when you're in and you've got the position, then you're still learning. Because when you have a position, you're forced to learn and understand what is happening.
This is not only the trading experience itself, it's always
it's also a life experience, because we learn a lot of things with these guys. We're more experienced than us, and it's a full learning about everything, about perspective, about commitments, about objectives, and it has been really awesome these days, because every day you learn along the way. It's valuable information that we take from here.
Day three now of the classwork, and I can see the guys actually ahead of us are already at it. Got the laptops out, they're comparing notes, talking about the process. This is actually one of the things I really like about these offsites, is these guys get a chance to get to know each other, work together, go through the process together, and they really do form their own genuine trading desk. You know, one of the things I've noticed as a professional trader, and even I can see with retail, trading can be a very lonely experience at times. So having a support group like this just makes a world of difference, particularly for a retail trader who typically is on their own. So these guys have gone through the training together, they've done offsites together, you know, they've had dinners together, gotten to know each other socially as well, which I think really helps develop those relationships. And another role, genuinely helping each other with their homework assignments. You know, I'm assuming finding short trades to talk about in this classroom. But yeah, let's go have a look at them, because I think this is fantastic. I'm really pleased to see that this part's gelling so well.
Morning, guys.
Yep.
Morning.
How's the round table going? A lot of
grey matter busy at work.
Yeah, very good. Yeah.
Short ideas.
Short ideas. Gathering the details on the process, to making sure we have the same level of information.
Yep.
And in that case, we share and we get all. All comprehensive with each other and with the process, so we master it quicker.
Yeah, we are trying to be on the same page on all the information, because it's too much information, and we want to have a clear checklist for all of us.
Yeah,
and then when we have to share, after we finish the mentoring here, when we have to share our ideas, we know exactly what we are talking about.
Yeah, great.
That's very important.
Fantastic.
No, this is great. It's great seeing you all working so well together. I was hoping this would be the. This is my first offsite, and I was hoping that the remote trading desk would gel like this and work like this. So I'm really pleased to see you all working out as a team, because this will be an invaluable support network for you guys when next 6, 12, 18 months, 2 years, 5 years. Yeah, and this is hard to replicate. This is great, especially for retail traders. I think, it's living to it. They've got 15 minutes until we start, and they're working really well. Just watch them go for it.
Okay, so just to recap on the earning growth scenario. So we had the premium, so where everything is positive. Then we have lower than the sector, number two.
Premium three situations.
Yeah, premium three situations. At the level three situations.
At the level, so at the level, this one.
Yeah.
To figure
so
out.
It was four brains and three numbers, so somehow we managed to fit to fit the right stuff.
We obviously did long ideas. Last session. Today, Tristan's going to supervise homework and the process of short trade idea generation. Better now that you stand at the front, feel a bit of pressure in terms of pitching your trade ideas and feel the pressure of one, presenting it in front of a group to simulate doing it on the phone with your mentor, and two, the pressure of time. So fire away.
So I went with retail companies that deal with apparel. So I went, did a sector breakdown for stocks, stock screener, composed my own sector. They're a large cap, 9 billion. Their month and their year end has already gone, but for 2016, but I have data which can give us for 2017, which is this calendar year.
F1 is 2.53. If the guys get stuck and bogged down in process, when they jump on calls with their mentors, they're not getting the most out of the calls, because they need to be able to go through this, these mechanics, and present them within a few minutes. So the mentor gets their logic and gets their process and understands how they've arrived at an idea.
Just making sure that the data that they're looking at is correct. I think there was a problem with the sector data, but we've sorted that out. But otherwise, yeah, so continue.
So what have we got to now? We've got, and this is the thing about, you know, what Tristan was saying with the big super tankers yesterday, when we were out on the boats. Similar to the way pension funds and hedge funds operate, the big market cap companies, they're like the super tankers, like the pension funds. They can't turn around their business as quickly as the smaller guys in the industry. It could take them years to turn this around if they ever manage to do so.
When they announce their news, the market's priced in a 20-ish percent price correction based on news in the last few days. I mean, you're throwing darts at a board trying to guess if that should be 15 or 25 or 20. I mean, who knows?
We could be late to this short, given the moves already had, and I might be jumping the gun a bit because we're still doing the quantitative work.
1 hour later, we want to have a position. That's the most important thing, getting over the line on things.
I think if the process was easy, there'd be no value in it. There are no magic tricks with this. There's no magic method. It's just hard work. And the right process. So, you know, well, I'm sure the guys would be hoping for a bit of an easier coursework to work through. It wouldn't really get them anywhere. They would know deep down that it wasn't really that material that useful. I think after going through this and going through the ringer with Anton and seeing the proper process, and that it, although it's not easy to apply, once you get that muscle memory, it's not difficult either. But there is a barrier to entry for these guys actually understand the process and doing the work. So if they can get over that hump, they'll be in a much better place than most retail guys.
Yeah, of course it's a positive. You have to take a grilling, learn from your mistakes. My analysis has not been thorough enough. So it's a case of making sure they have a far enough process. Just like Tristan and Anton said, this does look like a good idea. There are good indicators, but I didn't get to the level of the analysis that both Tristan and Anton did, as you would expect. Learn from experts. If experts telling you off, at least they care enough to tell you off so you can do better. Worst thing is to just be by yourself and not have any guidance and make every mistake in the book and just lose all your money.
What I'm going to do, it's simply, I'm
going to help you. I'm learning here. I'm learning from my mistakes. And I will remember this lesson for the rest of my life. And I can apply it to other things in life.
Pain trade's the next. The pain trade is the trade that causes you the most pain. So however your portfolio might be positioned, it's important to know what your pain trade is, so that if the worst case scenario happens to your portfolio, you're not scratching around wondering why you lost so much money. You need to be aware of your maximum downside exposures and scenarios. What are the things that need to happen in the world to cause this current portfolio the most damage?
Yeah, it was a good and productive day. So now, as a team, we're gonna share the notes that we have in common to prepare the our next challenge, which is coming with a long and short, and it's all about the pain trade.
after applying all the filters, I still have plenty of things here. Look, I have basically right now something like 134 companies.
Yeah. So the bigger picture is we split off into teams now, and we've been given the task to find long and shorts for presentation tomorrow. So I'm looking at longs. Shorts in this market seems to be a lot harder to be finding good trades. So he's discussing and debating with Tristan how to best play his idea, which is in healthcare in the US market.
Qualitative stuff.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Which sector are you looking for?
Well,
where did you work?
We build a sector on transportation and warehousing.
Where they work in Australia?
But outside, then that contains a few energy related stocks.
Okay,
it's big, huge cap, right? So they do the global.
We are in Olinda. It's an historical part here in Recife, that it was basically where the Portuguese came when they discovered Brazil. So basically there's a lot of influence here, and you can see from the buildings of the Portuguese presence in this country. We will be here around today having an insight about the city itself. Right now we are going for a nice lunch, and it will be awesome. We will have time to discuss a few more things in general about life, trading, and everything.
Can you not do that with a stock, with an equity?
Well, there's a consensus, so you don't know whether they're going to meet or they're going to miss.
Or some bad people.
Yeah.
Dressed with
tofu,
olive oil, and
cheese.
Yeah, why don't you dress later?
Nice, thanks.
Because I don't like it with oil.
It smells good.
Yeah,
it smells good.
It's going for a little tour.
Hello.
Walking around. Very beautiful colonial architecture. And at the top of this hill, I've been told, it's an amazing view.
You can see from here, it's Beauviage, the beach. Let's drive along the beach.
Yeah.
But drilling along the beach.
Yeah.
O que é que tu gostas de Olinda, especialmente?
Tudo.
Tudo?
O carnaval.
O carnaval. He likes everything, especially the carnaval. He's from here, he's just born on the other side of the hill.
There you go, for you.
Present?
Para você. Yeah?
Obrigado.
Give me five.
Yeah, he's probably the age of my kid. Yeah, yeah. Looks quite cool, a cool dude. So I think he's even cooler with a Brazil football team hat. Yeah, that's cool.
We can say that it's the real deal. How people live here, being in contact with the locals, it's a great experience. It's something that makes us think. And it is poor people, but it's people with a good heart. No doubts on that. It's only live as much as they can for the life they have, and enjoy as maximum as they can. That's how they live here. It's really nice. When you come here usually, or when I come here usually, I always feel great. It's a great country with great people.
Ele é cinegrafista, eu vou fazer meu relatório. Ele vai fazer filmagem aqui desse repertório pro poeta, repentista e esse conservatório. Não sei se é da Hungria, que é grande lugar, mas ele...
Check out the bathroom down here. Turiales use the toilet. It's like charging for execution.
I think wherever you go in the world, you've got to get street level, see how the local people live, have a walk around, and understand the local culture.
Coming to the end of a fun trip. 2 days left. Seen a lot, done a lot, learnt a lot. We've certainly gotten to know each other, formed a good little team. And I think for a lot of these guys, there's been a lot of firsts. First time in Brazil for some of them, first time in boats and choppers for some of them. And they've definitely been exposed to a lot of concepts and ideas with trading that I don't think they're expecting to be seeing. So it's good for the guys to get a break, because they've been working pretty hard in the classroom, to have some downtime to come out and have a look around and experience the local colours and flavours.
The guy's probably from Brittany having a crêperie here. You know, when they're on holidays, you never left. They're everywhere, making crepes and salads, cider, making a fortune. Brilliant. long Brittany.
It has been a massive day with massive people, massive food, and a massive walk. Now there's a massive crowd. It seems that all the kids have came out from school. I think we are now going for some beers and relax a little bit, because we also deserve it.
Table for two.
Andrew, you blew me.
So good.
Today in the classroom, the guys were taking us through their pain trade ideas. So we spent some time in the last session talking about the idea of pain trades, what pain trades are, and how you might include some non-consensus ideas in your portfolio to help hedge out any pain trade risk your portfolio might have. So we're going to see what the guys have put together. They'll take us through their thinking as to what they think the pain trades are for 2016-2017, and take us through stocks they've selected that make sense around that pain trade. We'll do some quantitative analysis, hopefully some good qualitative analysis, and I imagine we'll look at some charts to think about timing entries into the stocks that they've selected. And hopefully we'll see some real progress around, you know, start to finish from the process. They go through it all, they nail it all, get it all right, and we can see some real development in how they've learned and how they're approaching it, and hopefully there aren't too many holes or gaps.
Okay, so last session, pain trade drivers and pain trade ideas. So the question is, is there still an oversupply of oil in the market?
Yeah. If everyone else devalues their currencies, then they have more purchasing power.
If we believe this is going to happen, what's the long idea? It's in the box of mega rally nonsense.
Mega rally nonsense.
No, but that's the point, is everyone, it'll be a rally and everyone will think it's nonsense. But if you don't participate, you lose it. That's the problem.
If they get caught out by this and don't see it coming, it could really cause them a lot of pain. But if they're aware of it, they could actually hedge themselves and position for it and actually make a ton of money out of it.
What do people think in the world? How are people positioned? And then you start to realize that things don't stack up. And expectations are actually way out of kilter versus the reality of what could happen.
We'll put it in blue because this is going to start.
Okay.
Showing us his view on the best stock in the energy sector, specifically the oil refineries sector, as he thinks that's the obvious place for a pain trade reversal. We spent the morning, Anton, going through more of the macro side to see what the likelihood is for a continued rally in crude, what would need to take place for crude to continue to rally,
what is the likelihood of that happening, and ascertain that the idea of crude being a pain trade makes sense. So now we're looking at the best, the absolute best company in that space, and looking at its data versus the sector.
Other refineries in the area, competitors, have been hit by severe weather and they just blown out of the area. So the last quarter of last year, they were getting a lot more orders, a lot more business.
Okay, what was the weather system that knocked everyone out? Is this like forest companies, public and shrimp companies?
That's the analogy I'd like to use.
Okay.
What the market is ready to pay for such a growth is relatively low.
The pegs.
The peg and the PE also.
Yeah. Analysts have these really bullish expectations, but for some reason the market just doesn't believe it or isn't giving the benefit of the doubt to the stock yet. So there's a lot of risk, but there's also a lot of opportunity. The point here is the pain trade is your hedge if you ever fall into the trap of having consensus trades on and you end up with no negative correlation in your portfolio. But we're recognizing the pain trade and going one step further and actually trying to make money from it. Like I actually quite like that trade.
One arrow I wasn't too happy about. Other than that, it's good. Anton says it's a good trade and I should put some money on it and forget about it. And then the pain trades come off, could be quite a sizable return.
If everything we say works in the way we think it's going to work. But no more than 20% of your portfolio should be exposed to this at any one time.
Above 10 million. So I ended up with mostly full of airlines, but you have some rail, just a few rail transportation, mm-hmm. and pipeline transportation. They're all similar from a market cap point of view. Most of their business is 98.7% in the US, and they have a mm-hmm. sort of a international, but with Mexico.
So there's no currency risk. Yep.
No, no currency risk. So very minimal.
Maybe they just put in a big oil hedge here at the low.
Yeah.
They've just gone massively long oil via a big hedge at the low. For 2 years starting yesterday, and Goldman's Morgan Stanley upgraded them yesterday, mm-hmm. and it's not short.
Yeah.
Okay. What are the drivers for the pain trade specific to this idea?
Is oil price to increase? So I have done a selection on transportation, warehousing, and to my filters on that is on companies in the US and companies market cap being greater than 10 billion. They mentioned that they hedged, obviously, for a period of 2 years, but I couldn't find an end date for that hedge, but I know that they started to hedge last year. Couldn't find anything negative related to this, you know, this move from 20% to 2%. Doesn't mean that it doesn't exist, but I read this, the earning report for early this year. They're reporting mid-April, 21st. So maybe I will have more indications on the next report.
So if we're gonna short this stock based on a higher oil price and a pain trade, what we want to be looking at encapsulating is a calendar that can actually capture it over a long period of time.
No, 875.
You're getting close to. If it works, you make $6,500. So if you put $1,000 into this, you're going to make $6,500 if it goes to 30.
It's not a bad trade. It looks quite good.
So, to summarize that process, it took a bit longer than expected today to go through that process. And again, the point of it is that you have to see the whole thing from start to finish. It's a bit of work. You've now seen it twice properly from start to finish. and we've ended up concluding on both occasions that we can actually go and purchase and commit capital to these ideas.
It's good. The guys work well together. They gelled well together. There was no one here who kind of slackened off or couldn't keep up or couldn't follow the coursework. So I think it's a strong team. I'm really pleased that they've spent this time together, going through this process together. It should make them all much better traders individually.
I think we're about done. What you should probably do now is just take a break. Take a break from looking at this stuff for like 5 to 7 days. Get some rest, ease back into life on the other side of the world. And I wish you good luck, gentlemen. I'll be watching from the back end.
Cool. So we're back in Olinda, the old city. Take care of some unfinished business. One final dinner, everyone to celebrate the end of a hard week's work.
Brilliant food every night, different type of restaurants. You enjoy the Brazilian meat, Brazilian fish, Brazilian everything. It's good to have good food with good people. Cool. Now, I definitely recommend this program to people, because I actually don't see how you could function without this relationship, the exposure to Anton and Tristan here. It's just precious, really.
So it's been a learning experience, a lot of learning from new life experiences, new part of the world, trading education, learning how to take the whole process and really drill down and nail each aspect and fully flesh out a trade idea. It's more than just saying, oh, I think I'll do this. There's a lot more detail and a lot more research you have to do, and learning from experts. It's fantastic.
When I finished the videos, it still felt theoretical, and I would have struggled to have implemented that in practice. There's a lot of time spent in bars and restaurants, which is fun in itself, but it also translates into the way in which you can have a connection with the mentor and the mentees, share notes, which I think is an important part of assimilating and internalizing what we've learned this week. We all have the same interest and strong financial interest in sharing what we know with others. It's a good experience.
Wow. I think that is the best expression that I can use to classify the weekend. My approach is completely different. I would say it's a 180 degrees turn, because when you follow a certain path and then you are faced with a completely different reality, you realize that you were on the wrong path. So it's a U-turn that you have to do and follow. He's a great guy, easygoing, and I think we have a lot to learn with him, with his experience. And for sure, we will have time now that we'll be in a more close contact along these next 3 months to learn more and get some more ideas and tips and advice for our journey that starts now. There was no any kind of separation between us or the mentors. Basically, we, along these 10 days, we have been together the entire day. During the activities, during the classroom, during the breaks, everything. So it was basically a group of friends who came to Brazil to have a nice holiday, but a business holiday, if we can say it this way.
Guys, it's been fantastic. Great week. It's been really good watching the development, how far you've all come. It's going to be an exciting 3 months.
I've had an awesome time with you all in Brazil. We can do these things anywhere in the world. We pick our countries, we pick our times. And I think we've had an awesome time in this country. A great time of development in the classroom. And I'm looking forward to seeing all of your results through the back end of the Institute and via Tristan's mentoring. Cheers, guys. Cheers.